So you should have a copy of that handout. You want to double click it. This is the blog checklist. This is not the be-all, end-all checklist, of course. Everyone's got an opinion on the right way to blog. Everyone is right and everyone is wrong. And the reason for that is because depending on your goals for your website, some of these things apply more than others, or maybe not at all. And so you'll find plenty of articles and tutorials and videos all about the right way or the best way to blog. And again, they're all valuable. But if you don't know any of these techniques, they're all valuable. If you know some of them, well, you can vary them. This is not the only way to do things. So I've got three main sections: planning, writing, and then at the end, promoting. Those are the three big concepts that you need to think about when you're blogging. Three big concepts of blogging: planning, writing, promoting. I'll take that. Everyone got it now. Thank you. Did everyone get the sign-in sheet back up? Planning, writing, and promoting. In the first section, I have here this concept that we talked about a little bit previously: decide on hosted versus self-hosted. Kim, could you be a little quieter?
I'm sorry.
Yes. So will your site be on one of the free platforms, or will it be on your own server? We talked about that previously, that we can get WordPress.com, or we can go buy some space at a service provider. We talked already about the pros and cons of that, and the one that's recommended is the self-hosted one. So recommendation, self-hosted. That's the one with an address like victor.com, victorsblog.net, victorstudiodesigns.org, whatever. I have my own server. I have my own hosting, and we'll have a deeper discussion on that later. But this is one of the things you need to decide early on, because the alternative is for you to get victorsbakery.wordpress.com or victorssocialmediacompany.blogspot.com. You are using someone else's host. You're using someone else's name in the address. And the reason why the self-hosted is better is because you get all the traffic. You get all of the positive result of getting traffic to your site, because if you've got myamazingwebdesigns.blogspot.com, you're giving all the traffic to Blogspot and all of that entails, and the limitations that that entails. So self-hosted is better, because it's more powerful. You don't have the limitations like the other companies. If you get a website at WordPress.com, you're limited from installing plugins. And plugins are mini apps that give you lots of extra features. Last week, we created a WordPress.com account simply because I'm not going to ask you in this class to go out and buy a self-hosted account. It's not free. We created the WordPress.com. We're going to use it again a little bit later once we talk about all of these concepts. But the big recommendation is get your own self-hosted account. Now, of course, as I talk about all of these, if you have any questions, raise your hand and we'll discuss deeper. Yes.
Very basic. It's been driving me crazy.
Sure.
So I have a website that's hosted on iPage, and then I'm using WordPress to build the site.
Mm-hmm.
Do I need something else for the blog, or because it says posts and pages on the WordPress?
WordPress can allow you to create a classic blog type of site and also a static kind of site, or hybrid in the middle. So the short answer is no. WordPress does it all. WordPress lets you have a blog and a classic website and everything in between. So your iWeb
on one host,
yeah. It's all just that one software, the WordPress software, you use to create either blog posts or pages or everything, and then you upload it to the one host.
Okay, maybe in the break you can show me, because I've been working on this for like a week.
Mm-hmm.
I figure it out.
Sure. Yes.
Is it the thing on the .org that we, whatever, last week, that's the self-hosted, the paid one, right?
Yes.
Is everything, not everything, but is it the features and the settings and all the buttons and everything, is it pretty similar to what we're going over in WordPress? So if we do decide to pay, we'll kind of be a little bit familiar with it?
Yes, over at WordPress.com, remember, as soon as you sign in, you get the training wheels.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said right away, let's switch over to the dashboard, the
yeah.
real thing. So yes, what they're showing at WordPress.org assumes you're in the dashboard.
Oh, okay.
And so whatever you use on either one, as long as it's the dashboard, it's all the same and it's all universal.
Okay.
So non-paid, paid. Easy to work with, more advanced. You'll have the most control and power and everything with .org, but yes, it's more to deal with, and I think the learning curve of WordPress is not so bad as opposed to other kinds of software. Then we've got develop a series concept. This is part of the activity that we did at the end of the day previously, where we had some time to brainstorm ideas for everyone about what you could write. Well, almost everyone. But you saw that we had these concepts that applied to various people's sites. If someone had a cooking site and we talked about developing a series of content, that series of content could be applied also to a different kind of site, like a financial news website. So the concept is, what can you write about in the long term? A blog should entice people to come back to your site time after time. Plan content that you would be happy to constantly write about. Because what often happens is people start a blog, either for fun or for profit or for SEO. They start it and they're really gung-ho about it for a bit. And then they miss one of their self-imposed deadlines. So then they miss the next self-imposed deadline, and then before you know it, no more blogging. So any positivity that you get out of blogging then is nullified because you're not blogging anymore. And blogging is a long-term endeavor. It is something that you should do on a regular basis, as we will see in many other parts of this handout. So brainstorm ideas that you will be happy to write about in the long term. And really, the long term, if you want to think about it in one way, the long term is forever. Well, as long as you have your site up, as long as you have your business up, as long as you want to build traffic for it, maybe at a certain point you have enough traffic already in sales that you don't need any more customers and such, so you don't have to engage in SEO as much. That's a good problem to have. I run into people like that once in a while, that they've got a personal business, a family business, but they don't take any more clients because the dozen or whatever that they have is self-sustaining. And therefore, when I say, you're not on Facebook, I don't see you active on Twitter. And they say, well, we don't need any more customers. We're doing fine the way we are. Not many of us can say that, so we do have to engage then as much as possible in SEO to create content. Yes.
If this is long term, how do you keep it from getting clogged up in so much verbiage on your site?
Well, it's very easy to organize your content. One of the other points later on here will be about organization.
Mm-hmm.
Because the default WordPress, yes, is that your latest blog post will take over the top and push down the last one, and you'll have lots and lots and lots of stuff. But organization helps you prevent that. We'll use categories and tags later on, and we can organize content by screen so that it's not so cluttered. And all of that content, don't think about it as clutter. Visually, I could possibly think about it cluttered, but don't think of it content-wise as clutter, because all of that text, all of those pages of content, those are the things that are helping you get found. So the more content you have, the more possibility that the search engine can find you. Some quick ideas here: top 10 lists, testimonial articles, weekly. Just as an example, I have the fictional company Victor's Bakery. I'm going to do recipe of the week. Is there something that you could do on a weekly basis? Okay, not weekly. Recipe of the month. Good enough also. Once a month, once a week, once a day, once every other month. Whatever goal works, as we'll see later, as long as you do it on a regular basis. And if you're going to do it on a regular basis, you're going to get writer's block eventually. Yes?
Can you give an example, recipe of the week?
Pecan pie recipe of the week, favorite wheat pizza dough of the week, that sort of thing.
Okay.
Just recipe.
I gotcha.
And then this can be changed to any other sort of something of the week. Let's say I'm a web designer, I'm going to write web design tip of the week. So anything that I can do, quick article of the week. We have here spotlight, a type of spotlight article. Like in this case, I would say, again, my Victor's Bakery. I have probably a variety of talented bakers and chefs, personnel that work for me. And so once a month, once a quarter, whatever, I can write an article about that person, a spotlight on that person. Well, that sounds very narcissistic. How does that help SEO? As we will see on the other things here, we're going to write an article thinking always in terms of keywords and things people are searching for. So a jumping off point, a catalyst is I'm going to write an expose on Janet, one of my pastry chefs. But in there, I'm going to be writing about how she is really focused on gluten-free baking or alternative healthy ingredients. And those are things people are searching for, healthy alternative to sugar. And I wrote something about that in that article as a spotlight of one of my employees. Now, of course, the more true it is, the better. And if you need to embellish things, well, that's up to you. But these are different ideas, and we had that whole brainstorming session last week for other ideas, and you can get back to those brainstorming ideas in the network folder. The link is there to get back to those ideas. So what are you going to be happy about writing in the long term? Number three. Number three here, variety. These two are related. Develop a series, concept, and variety. Within your niche of expertise, plan on a variety of related topics. Instead of always writing about one subject, plan also writing on 2 to 3 related ones. So it's better to say here directly, we have variety, right? So I'm a web design company. So maybe main series is web design tips. Ancillary series topics related to web design. Well, I can't make a website unless I have my website online somewhere. So, top 5 hosting provider pitfalls. Some article where I'm going to say top 5 things to watch out for when you're going to get a hosting provider. The main idea is I'm going to be writing about these web design tips and experiences or whatever. And once in a while, something related to it, some variety. It still relates to web design, but it's a different kind of concept. I'm giving you all these web design tips, and maybe I can do some sort of like inspiration of the month, and then an article, Adobe Font Factory. So I'll write an article about the Adobe Font Factory. Or I'll write an article about something else inspiring. You know, the best icons, the best app icons. I'm a web design company, and we deal with a lot of visuals as well when you're a web designer. So something about inspiration. Because as we go back to the previous one, what is going to entice people to come back to your site? If you spend all your time in writing one amazing magnum opus of an article, okay, great, what's next? We live in a culture that is very short attention span to some degree, and what's next, what's new, what else can you give me, what are you doing for me now? And so writing that one article and thinking to coast on it via SEO forever, it's not going to work. You're going to need to keep up to date because your competition could be much more current than you, and you're going to fall behind. Well, if I'm saying that you need to be writing on a regular basis and a variety of content, are you going to do it all yourself, or are you going to have help? Are you going to write everything yourself? Are you going to have other people on your organization write as well? Are you going to have ghostwriters, guest writers, paid writers?
What's a ghostwriter?
I'm about to explain all of these in just one moment. So, how to prevent burnout or writer's block. I don't know what to write again this month. I don't know what to write again this week, etc. Yes.
What would you recommend for article length? I've seen blogs that have
Before you go on, I'm gonna get to that,
sure.
And it's in here as well. We'll get to it soon. So solo, guest writers, ghost writers, paid writers. Solo obviously is yourself. You are writing everything. Well, the problem with that is not only do I have to run my business and do the payroll and deal with inventory, now I've got to write once a month and I'm not good at writing? Well, it's going to show in the quality of what you're writing. So unless you like to write, you know how to write, you might not want to write. Guest writers, and of course is other people writing for you. Now, you have to decide if the other people, guest writers, ghost writers, paid writers, you have to decide if these other people are going to take their credit or not. Will they take credit or not? That is much more focused on actually ghost writer. Someone else writes for you in your name.
So if they put their name to it as a guest writer, you don't get the credit for it?
You do, because it's on your site. It's on your site, you're getting the traffic. But the point of why someone might be a guest writer is because then they can also often link back to their own site to get a little bit of traffic, to piggyback a little bit on your popularity. We'll see the reverse of that is also valuable for us in a moment. And so a guest writer, you can ask someone, you can do a trade, you can go to some other related kind of website, maybe not direct competition, but some other website related, and say, would you like to write for me? Again, whatever you decide, however you decide it, that they will write on your site for more content, and either you're going to pay them, and that's the fourth one here, they're simply going to take credit there on their own article. Maybe they're going to take credit and you'll allow them to have a link back to their site, whatever you decide verbally, or better yet, written contract. This could be a way for you to write on the regular basis. If solo isn't going to work for you, you can mix all of these up too. Maybe all year long I'm going to write 7 articles once a month, and then out of the last few months, you've got a guest writer. Paid, of course, based on your agreement with them, someone else writes. And again, you're paying someone else, but are they going to take the credit, or are you going to take the credit? Again, it's how you decide to hire them. I might hire someone, I don't know, $10 an article, whatever, $40 an article. There's just a huge range about how much people get paid for this stuff. Let's just say $30 per article, you're paying Janet, and she's going to write an article every month for you, $30 a month. And then you've also made it part of the contract. She won't take any credit. The $30 is enough. And so you're going to put your name on it, and it's all your content on your website. Perfectly fine agreement. Maybe then you're working with Jill, and she says, okay, I want to charge you $20 an article, but I want credit on it, so get to link back to my site. Then you decide if it's valuable to you or not. This is how you prevent burnout, writer's block, have other people work. I mentioned here in the note, what about getting other people in your organization also? I'm Victor's Bakery, and then I'm going to hand off to one of my chefs, one of my bakers, to also write once in a while. The problem with having other people in your organization write is that, do they know how to write? Do they want to write? Do they have the time to write in addition to their main duties? If I'm getting Janet in accounting to also write articles once in a while, does she want to write? She's busy with accounting. Do I want to get Bill to also write in between his delivery stops throughout the city? Does he have time? Does he want to? Can he write? So all of this goes back to quality content. So that's the section on planning, things you need to think about before you start writing. Any questions on this section? Okay, so then there's a section on writing. Here we have very quickly, frequency, length, title, description. We have all of the things then on the actual writing. I have to be as general as possible on these concepts because it's going to depend on you, what you're trying to do, you, what your business is, you, what your goals are. So I can't always be very specific on each thing, but of course that's why we have lab time, that's why you can email me, that's why you can ask questions and we can talk. But in general here, the very first thing to think about when writing is frequency. No matter your schedule, the important thing to do is blog consistently. Start off with a once-a-month blog if you're not used to blogging. Once a week is better, once a day is best. A few times a day is bestest. Because the more content you're creating, the more you can be found. These sites that you visit on a regular basis, think about, do they have something new for me to see every day? Probably. I like to visit a lot of tech sites, a lot of tech blogs, a lot of sites where something new, a new news article, a new commentary, a new review, that's blogs, blogging. They have something new all the time. And you probably notice it's different people in that website writing. That's the guest blogging, that's the paid writing.
I have a question about the frequency.
Yes.
So in something like that, if somebody signed up on your blog to receive emails when you blog, and you're blogging daily, won't it feel like they're being bombarded with emails if you're blogging on a regular basis?
Yes, but it's going to depend on the person. If the person chose to subscribe to you, the way you set up your subscription system perhaps is by telling them, you will most often get a once a week email, or you will get many daily emails. The built-in default WordPress, I believe it will send an email every time there's a new article. I think with an extra plugin, it can send it as a digest, which is that everything in one email once a day or once a week or something. Mm-hmm. So there are ways to control that. And you had a question over here?
Oh, yes. So that I can really grasp the whole search engine optimization tech and how it works with blogs. Say, for example, someone does a search for how to be sane in a crazy world, those exact words, and that happens to be the title of your blog that day. Will it immediately come up then? Because those exact words?
No. I'm
not seeing how they connect. I'm seeing how the search engine thing works with blogs.
Well, you are on the right track, but what the part that's not quite right is how fast does it happen? Yes, if someone types those exact words, eventually on the search engine that will make you appear. Eventually. Depending on other aspects of SEO, if you have your site optimized, if you have your site connected directly to the search engine, if you write an article with that exact keyword title and someone searches that, you could be found faster if you properly do all the optimization. If you simply haven't engaged in any SEO but start writing articles, it might take weeks or months for that to get you found.
You need to pay to get the search optimization stuff.
No. If you pay, you will get it faster, even faster. But if you engage in the free stuff that I talk about in my other SEO class, that helps you get found. Maybe doing it in the free way helps you get found in 1 month. Doing it in the paid way gets you found in 1 day. Not engaging in any of that might not ever get you found. So it's just how fast you want to get found.
And so a lot of it has to do with the words, the specific words that you're using in your blog. It picks up certain words.
Yes, exactly. That's distilling SEO down very basically, which is a good way to do it. But yes, it's all about the words. What are people searching for? What do people want? That's the whole point. That's why the search engines rank a website higher that has stuff that people want. If I've got a website just writing about my experiences in life, and really, who cares about that? But if I'm writing about daily tips and affirmations and my experiences and how they relate to everyone, that could get found a lot easier because it's what people want to read, and therefore the search engine wants to show that. Question?
I just want to clarify, so based on what you said and then the last class, I'm getting that the blogging is just kind of a piece of the puzzle that the search engines are looking for.
Yes.
To find your website. So this, along with a few other things that they like to see, like videos you mentioned last time.
And being active on social media.
Yeah.
And having a well-designed website and having a speedy website and a mobile website and all the things we talk about in the other class.
So overall, really clean presence, and this is just one nice big piece that they also like to see.
Yeah, content.
In order to give us credit to show up.
Yes,
okay.
Because the search engines, as they evolve, there have been many techniques to get you ranked. The techniques eventually get abused by spammers, so a new technique has to be emphasized, and one that's working at the moment is content. Spammers cheat by writing, 10 articles, but then those same 10 articles get sold to this site and get sold to that site and that to that site. So then suddenly all of these sites have the exact same 10 articles, and the search engine sees that and says they're spammers, and it lowers them. So it's about original content, and that helps you much more than any of the older techniques. So the frequency is any frequency, any schedule that you want to do. I have a goal there. The most basic goal is once a month. You can probably think about writing one article once a month, once every 30 days. And yes, you're going to see plenty of articles that tell you, you better be blogging every week. Sure, that's a better answer, more content. And then another is going to tell you, no, you better be blogging every day. Of course that's a better answer, it's more content. But for a beginner, where I'm busy running my business, and now I've got to write also, once a month is a good goal. Because that helps you create these keywords and content that people want to search for, and the search engines want to rank. Length. Again, everyone's going to have an opinion. Here's one. If you're a beginner, 100 words once a month. Very easy goal. You can write 100 words very quickly. 300 is better. Okay, if you've got 300 words to write once a month, that's even better. It's more content that can help you get found. If you blog more than once a month, you can vary it. These ranges. You can go up to 500 words, sure. But the problem of writing really long articles is, what's next? So if you think about writing 500 words, what about if you write part one, 250 words this month, and you've got another article ready for next month, part two, 250 words? Yes?
So is 500 words the average length of a good blog?
Nope. Any amount of length is good, even down to 100 words. It's just you have to write something.
Okay.
So you're saying frequency is a little more important than length?
No. Content is the important one.
Content is more important than anything. Okay.
So those 500 words are very valuable, but what are you doing next month? So, start with 100 words once a month instead of writing 1,000 words. Break it into 10 months of content. If I'm doing 100, if I'm doing 100 words at a time, I could publish the first 100 words this month, and then at the end, and don't forget to come back next month for part two. So then the next 100 words, and then say, don't forget next month, part three. So that's one way to keep people coming back. Maybe 100 words at a time in this case might be too small. Maybe the thought isn't complete enough. whatever amount. I'm just saying, yes, you can easily write 1,000 words. But why not save it and parse it out a little bit? Break it up into some sort of schedule. Okay, maybe you're going to not wait a whole month between your 100 words of 1,000 words here. Maybe you'll do it weekly then. So that's 10 weeks of content. Your first 100 words this week, and then next week 100 words in the next week. WordPress has a way for you to schedule your posts. You can write all 10 posts on a weekend and tell WordPress, we'll see how later, to publish one this month on Monday, and to publish it next month on the first Monday, and then the third month on the next Monday, all in a sequence automatically for you. You just have to provide the content. WordPress can schedule it. Use the WordPress scheduling system. To auto post your articles. So on a regular basis, you can have it do it for you. So unfortunately, you can judge a book by its cover. You can judge an article by its title, because the search engine looks at that and focuses on it a lot. What's the title of this article? Why should we show it to people? What are people searching for? Here's an article of what they're searching for, the title. Yes, the search engine scans every inch of your article, but the first thing that it looks at is the title. So try for a short, memorable, and direct title. Think in terms of content that people need and want to read. So if I'm writing on a tech blog, my review of the Toshiba T75, a winner, people would be searching for Toshiba T75 review, or T75 testimonial, or Toshiba laptop review. So I'm not going to create a title that has 50 words in it to try to reach everyone that's searching. I'd set up here a short one, because at a certain point your title gets cut off on the search engine. So we'll see how long in a little bit more directly when we get into WordPress. But you're going to think about a certain amount of length and space here where the most important things are visible as soon as possible. Keyword review, keyword Toshiba. A lot of times people think about putting the name of their company as branding up on their title. Nowadays, you don't need it. You need, what is the content? What is the article? What is the blog post? So focus on writing keywords in your title, early in your title. So if I have a title of a page of mine that says Victor's Bakery Sugar Alternatives, it has the keyword Sugar Alternatives. But the first things that appear are the name of my site. Not necessary. A better way would be Sugar Alternatives, a review by Victor's Bakery. Because I have those keywords, Sugar Alternatives, I have review, and then I have my company. You don't even need your company up on your title. Don't waste the space of the title up there with self-promotion. You're going to get it from a lot of other avenues. Use as much as possible that title. So maybe perhaps an even better one, Sugar Alternatives for Your Healthy Living. No mention of my company. No, not necessary. I'm using up all of the, make sure you spell these things right, of course. No mention of my own company, and I'm using up all the space as possible for the keywords that people might be searching for. And we will see that's not the only place for keywords, of course. So that's what I'm saying. Don't write 50 words here to try to catch people's keywords, because the content itself, the paragraphs that you wrote, are full of keywords too. The search engines look at everything about your article. the title, the content, the excerpt, the alt text, the captions of your pictures, all of that stuff that we will look at together, of course. But they look at all of that. The search engine has to decide, is this a good article to show people that they're searching for? Or is it another spam article written and found on 7 other spam sites? And so, this is one of the harder ones to teach because, again, I have to say it generically in that sort of concept. I can't apply it to everyone. What is everyone writing here? We had the brainstorming session last time, thinking about what we talked about that time. If I was able to get to you and what I've just mentioned right now, you can hopefully better decide on your titles. And you can always change your titles whenever you want. If that particular article is not getting very much traction, well, maybe it's because the title is not the best it could be, and you could change it. Yes?
I just got a little lost on the make sure you're filing to move them without an alt text to each.
Yeah, we haven't gotten to images yet.
Oh, okay, great.
The thing about title, though, especially in WordPress, is that it's often related to the address of your posts. So, titles in WordPress directly relate to URLs, addresses. So if I write something like Sugar Alternatives for Your Healthy Living, most likely that will become something like http://blog/sugar-alternatives-for-your-healthy-living. That'll happen automatically in WordPress, in most modern blogging software. The title of your article becomes the address, and that's good because if I was doing this in the old days and I was writing it myself, maybe I wrote something like sugararticle.html. Well, that's so basic and simple, it doesn't have those keywords that people would be searching for, and I also did it wrong here because then the search engine might think of that as one word, sugar article. No, it's two words, sugar article, dividing it with a dash. So if I'm saying that by default WordPress is going to take the title of your article and put it as an address, a moment ago I also said it's okay to change your titles. But if you change your title, if you change your human readable title, it might change your computer readable title, it might change your address. And therefore, you might create broken links. So I'm going to say, be careful. About changing titles, unless you also prevent broken links.
Sorry.
Yes.
Is that so? Does that mean kind of like if somebody liked your article and they wanted to bookmark it and then you change the title and they go back, it might not work?
Exactly.
Okay.
That's a very direct way. If they bookmark your article, you change the link, that link is no longer there. It's like a house that used to be on 123 Main Street and you've moved the house to 576 Second Street. It's not there anymore. You've moved it. Now, with WordPress, we have the ability to do what are known technically as 301 redirects. So I'm going to say use 301 redirects. It sounds technical. It is technical. I won't be able to show exactly how to do that until a little later. Just make a note, use 301 redirects to prevent broken links. On a technical level, what's happening is someone visits the old link and your site tells them, actually, this link has moved permanently over here. Mm-hmm. And the person automatically gets moved, all behind the scenes, to the new article. How you do it again, we can't really talk about it right now yet. But in WordPress, we can redirect our links. If I was doing this in the classic way, like Dreamweaver, it was rather complicated to do. But if you're doing it in a modern way like us, like WordPress, or Joomla, or Drupal, or all of these modern ways, Wix, Weebly, Squarespace, whatever, there should be a relatively easy way to redirect your links to not get broken links. Because yes, the search engines also look at this. And I can't tell you, well, the search engines don't like broken links. But I can't tell you, if you've got 7 broken links, you're going to drop down 2 spaces. I can't tell you like hard values. I don't know them. The search engines don't tell us these things. Some of this is proprietary trade secrets. But some amount of links, broken links, on your site is going to be detrimental to you. Maybe even 1 or 2, maybe 20. I don't know. It depends on the site and many other factors. That's one of the many SEO concepts. If the search engine analyzes your site and you've got lots of broken links, why would we show that to someone that's searching if your site's all broken? The search engine wants to show good, authentic, relevant content to people, not a site that's all broken. And yes, the search engine can track all of that. If you wrote an article and you wrote a link from your article to someone else's article and their article moved and your link didn't change, that's a broken link. That'll ding you. If you've got an article within your own site and you link to one of your other articles in your own site and you change the address of that article and you didn't fix it, you've got a broken link. That'll ding you. So you can change your titles, but I would say be careful unless you know what you're doing with these 301 redirects. And if you don't know about that, don't change your titles then. Leave them as is, but the content of the article you can change just fine. We will see that we can write a description. When you do a search on any search engine, and you're searching for whatever topic, every search engine by default is going to give you a page of results, of course, with very specific things to see. So just as an example here, what is Huitlacoche? And then I look here. Number one result is one of our clients, even higher than Wikipedia, apparently. I guess they've gone up. And so what you're seeing on any search result is a title, link, and a description, a little excerpt. So this is how, as I said about how do you judge a book by or judge a book by its cover, this is the cover of your article, of your website. And so you have the spot here to write the keywords, and there's keywords in the description, and then there's the, I mean in the address, and in the description. And the search engines are getting smarter and smarter. I wrote Huitlacoche, and an alternative term for it is corn smut. So Huitlacoche, oh, it's right here actually. And so keywords that are appearing here, look at these bold keywords. This was written in July 2016. Very recently written this month, or maybe updated this month. This article has been around a couple years now, but it's still ranking very highly because of the many factors of SEO that it's got, as we'll see the alt text and internal and external links and the length of it and all of these factors of SEO. This one is much newer, and one of the factors to help you rank also is newness and many other things. But even the much newer article doesn't rank as highly as the established articles that have been around. And so, description. In about 150 characters, you should be able to explain what your post is about to people who come across it in a search results page, entice them to click and read. So if the title is enough for them to click and to read, great. But you also have a little spot here for some more enticement definition. A fungus that grows on ears of corn. Origins, Huitlacoche dates back to the Aztecs who enjoyed the naturally occurring corn fungus as a part of their diet. So one of our clients that we have here, Mexican food restaurant, they serve a lot of traditional Mexican food, so it's not like nachos and California burritos, it's traditional authentic food that a lot of people haven't heard about, such as Huitlacoche, which is, yes, it is this corn fungus. It is corn that is infected with this fungus that makes it into these weird, interesting gray and blue tones. So people are like, ew, why would I eat fungus? Well, who eats mushrooms? Who eats escargot? Who eats all of this traditional ethnic food? Everyone. And so people that are interested in this search, and they find an article of that restaurant, and they say, oh, they sell it too? Let me click buy now. Let me book a table. So the point of blogging for that client is to get these keywords out there, people that are searching for, maybe people that, you know, expatriates that have come to live in the US from Mexico, they have a little hunger pain for the down-home cooking, haven't had a wheat like Wichita taco in a long time, this restaurant sells it, one of the few that does. So it's an article, but the point of the website is to get people to buy now, book a table. And further with this description helps you get ranked. I know I wrote there 150 characters, but I shouldn't have quite written an actual value because that changes. It used to be, I think you can write 170 characters, and then Google changed it so that it's 150 characters. They made the font larger. Larger font means less text in that little spot. And so a better way simply is a short, direct, keyword rich description of each article or page of your site. Helps you rank better. How to do it, we'll get to that a little later, but WordPress has a little spot for you to add an excerpt. And the search engine can see that and show it on the results page. An article doesn't have to be all text. An article should also have an image or two. Choose images that relate to the topic. Use your own original images or appropriate stock images with keywords royalty-free or public domain. And I have a link there that I recommend, pixabay.com. Because you can easily go do a Google search, a Bing search, a Yahoo search, and I want to find a picture of, let's say I'm going to write for Victor's Bakery, I'm going to write an article about pecan pie. So if I search a search engine for images of pecan pies, I'm going to find plenty of amazing pecan pie pictures. And I can easily right-click, save picture. But I shouldn't. I should use as much of my own original content as possible because the search engines look and analyze that as well. What's original? What's a copy? This article has appeared 50 times in a bunch of other sites. It's probably spam. This picture has appeared several times on several sites. It could be spam. Yes, the search engines can analyze all of these things about your site. Many, many, many things. And so what we want to say here is, with images, use your own images. Let's say, create and use your own images as much as possible. Sometimes I cannot create a picture of a burning house. If I'm an insurance salesman and I'm writing an article about why you need home insurance, I'm not going to go burn down a house to take a photo of a burning house. Maybe at that point, I will use a different photo that I didn't create. But then, if you use others' photos, make sure they're stock images or royalty-free images. Another term that I have in the handout is public domain images. Public domain. No one owns it. Because sometimes we forget, and if you don't know, intellectual property is a real thing in that you might believe that this phone right here, this piece of physical technology, is worth $300. Yeah, you know, buying a phone for that price, I believe it. It's got technology, glass, all of that. But you can buy a font, a style of text that is worth $300 because it's intellectual property. Someone invented it, someone created it, someone wants to sell it, just like a photo. I can take a snapshot of the San Francisco Bridge, or I can go to an art gallery and buy a photo of the San Francisco Bridge for $100, $1,000. It's intellectual property, it has a value. So that all relates to don't use other people's images. You don't know if someone is trying to make money off of them. And even though every single website you can easily right-click, save image, you shouldn't. You don't know if someone owns the copyright. I think I see a little watermark down here, and on most of them, most likely, then, you can't assume. I'm not even going to... The most likely what I was going to say, I'm not even going to say that. You can't assume it. You can't assume if the person is putting it up online and they're happy for you to copy it because they've got their watermark. You don't know if it somehow ended up there and they didn't think it would end up there. So it's better not to assume that any picture you find online you can use. Instead, I would do a search, pecan pie picture, royalty free. Or pecan pie picture, public domain. Or pecan pie picture, stock image. This does not guarantee, however, on a regular search engine, that the results you get is exactly what you're looking for. So much stuff gets mixed up on these results. So even though I put these words in, why did I still get that letter from that lawyer? Well, you still don't know. Someone could have bought the picture for $10 and then they tried to resell it or they tried to put it up online somehow, and now you're catching the brunt of that. So I've got instead, why don't you go directly to a place that specializes in safe images, images that are okay for you to use. You're not going to get, let's see, did it tell me here, curiosity? It doesn't tell me how many results of pecan pies appeared. Let's say at least 1,000. But what if I go to Pixabay and search for pecan pie? Very few. Not really that many good ones, unfortunately. But still much safer than seeing about on some search engine. You don't know what will appear. You don't know what you'll get. You don't know then if you will get, at best, an email that says, please remove your picture from my site. At worst, please remove your picture from my site and you owe me $100 because you violated my copyright. Or at worst case scenario, please remove your picture from my site and you owe me $100 and here's my lawyer. So you don't know what's going to happen. Be safe and use safe images. You can, of course, go to places like Corbis. They're Getty Images. This is all about finding a lot of great, useful images. Most of these, though, you have to pay. You say, pay $5 for a picture? I can go find one on Google. Yes, and risk some problem with lawyers. As I said, honestly, I've seen a font for $2,000. My computer doesn't even cost $2,000. And here's one font, here's one style of letters that's worth $2,000. Yes, if you do this stuff for a living, graphic design and all of that, these assets have a value. All right. slides. Here's an amazing pecan pie photo. Plans and pricing. Access all images, $99. Okay, I don't want to pay for that, so I'll take a photo of my own pecan pie. So be safe with images. Someone probably owns it. It's intellectual property. On a technical level, make sure your file names are meaningful and you've added alt text. So if I take a photo out of my camera, most likely I'll say it this way first. Rename your picture file names to something meaningful. Because most likely, right out of my digital camera, that photo that I just took of that great pecan pie is img_0032.jpg. That's not good. Better is pecanpie.jpg. So yes, the search engines even look at that. If you've put pictures onto your articles and they're still simply called that, that could ding you as well. How much and how many do I have and what's my limit? I don't know. That's, again, trade secrets. They don't tell you some of these things. But what they do tell you is don't leave your images like that, because a spammer does that, a lazy web designer does that, and you're not either of those, are you?
So you're saying then that when you download your own picture from your own files, it doesn't say it. It's not typed in there, that name, but it travels with it.
Exactly. The original file name, yeah, it travels everywhere it goes online, and it comes with that. So when you change it to something meaningful like that, better. Here's another thing right here. The way I like to do it is pecan pie image 0032. I leave the original unique designator here in addition to the keywords, because if I change this image to pecan pie and for whatever reason I edit it in Photoshop, I need to go back to the original image. I'm never going to find the original image. Every picture that I take, I back it up somewhere safe, and then I work with a working file. And then if I need to get back to the original file, if I renamed my file like this and a year later I want to go back to the original image, there's no image in my backups called pecan pie. The original is image 32. So if I put my keywords into the title and leave the original title, when I search my hard drive, I'll find my original image, the full high quality one that I can then crop or resize, whatever. So when I say rename your pictures to something meaningful, use keywords in your picture file names. Whenever a picture is on a website in the code, it's referencing a file. The search engine can look at a website and all of its code and see image equals img32jpg. So the search engine can scan all the code of your site in a millisecond and see that all of your images, you didn't try. You didn't follow their guideline about rename your images. And so then it'll be one demerit against you, and I don't know how many demerits then fully hurt you, but you might as well avoid them. And yes, it's extra work here. Not really, because as soon as I copy it from my memory card to my desktop, I'm going to give it a name and then use it. It's part of my workflow. Now, if you already have a website that exists, I wouldn't quite worry too much about going back and fixing all of your images that you never fixed. From now on, you're going to apply these things. It's going to be better if you're active on your site to all of these things that we're learning, start applying them now. To retroactively go back, it might not be as helpful as creating new content moving forward. Once your new stuff is out there, yes, you can go back little by little to perhaps fix the old stuff, but then of course be careful about broken links and all of that kind of thing. Yes?
Should you do that if you use stock images too? Like, how can you change?
The stock image often comes already named well.
Okay.
It often comes in this sort of format. I've gotten plenty of stock images that have the keywords of what the picture is plus the original number, so I can always trace it back to the original image at the stock image company. Yes?
Can you put your own photograph of yourself into your web page?
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a JPEG thing. In order to do it correctly, you would take the image out, go back into the file, change the name of the file, and then
Yeah, pretty much, re-upload it.
Reloaded the photo. That's the only way of changing the name.
Yeah, because in WordPress especially, I don't believe it lets you do that. You upload it and there it is. You just use it.
Okay.
So you'd have to rename it. And that's why I said you might not really need to do that on your older content moving forward. But maybe if it's very valuable, your picture, if you yourself are the face of your company and it's very important, then yes, maybe it's important for you to go back and edit that particular picture that it file name is the most correct. You can also do a little bit of stealth branding here. This one's optional. But what you can also do is, in addition to having those keywords and such, you can put in your company name there also, Victor's Web Design. So then you've got the name of your company in the file name as well, a little bit of branding as well. And that could help you possibly regarding also if your image gets stolen. Also, if you put a watermark on your image, and that's another discussion, but basically if an image is online, it could be very easily stolen, unfortunately. You could do it, and it could be done to you. Yes?
And do you need the words image and the numbers there? Is that important?
No, it's just that in my case, the original, my camera saves it that way.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes a camera saves it as DISM99. Whatever the original file name, I'm just keeping the original file name and then adding to it.
I see, so that you can find it then.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, so there I'm saying, in the note, I'm saying file names, think about your file names. And then also it's saying, and this one is going to actually be more important, alt text. So file names, keywords and file names are important. What's more important is use alt text. Alt text, short for alternative text, is a description of the picture. It has to be done in a special way. We will see how to do that in WordPress later. But the point of alt text is for accessibility purposes. Now think about this. Did you know that people that are completely blind can still go on websites and use websites? Websites seem to be something that you need to see to know where to click and what to buy and all of that. But websites, if they're designed properly, can be accessed by anyone, even people that are completely blind. Because a person that would be blind would have either a special computer or software that reads to them what's on the screen. So if I'm using this software, Notepad, I have a special keyboard, most likely, that I've learned and memorized, which will allow me to do a keyboard shortcut to activate the file menu. I have to see and move my hand to click file. But if I have it memorized, see, I'm not going to use the mouse with the keyboard. I access the file menu, and I have it memorized then, the other keyboard combination to open a file, without having to ever use the mouse. On a website, if it's properly designed, that will also work. The website, the person visits a website and their screen reader, their computer will most likely tell them, link photos, link illustrations, link video, link audio, link sign in. It was the fifth link, so then I can press Control 5 or whatever, and it'll automatically click on sign in. I don't have to see where it is. I just click on my keyboard as my system is set up. Then it'll say sign in screen, email box, password button, sign in. So then I don't have to see to type. If I know how to type, I type it in and then I do sign in and I sign in. The problem, what breaks down, is images. Unless the image has also been described, when the computer gets to a particular spot, it'll say image, whatever.jpg, image, 1277.jpg, image, logo.jpg.
Where it breaks down is that the computer doesn't know what to say when a picture shows up. And yes, some kinds of pictures that are text perhaps can get analyzed. But what about a picture
you know, if you're not paying attention very, very quickly, which of these are the Eiffel Tower?
None of these are the Eiffel Tower. This is the Tokyo Tower, especially at night. That looks like the Eiffel Tower. No, it's in Tokyo.
And therefore, if I were blind and I'm trying to buy a product, and it's a grid full of pictures, but none of the pictures have alt text, all the computer will say is image, 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 image. We will see that in WordPress we can add alt text, which is a basic, simple description of the picture. More important though, use alt text. A basic description, one sentence, a basic one-sentence description of a picture. Because then, when the blind user visits your site, it'll say, image, pecan pie large, buy now. Image, pecan pie small, buy now. And they will know what to click, what they're clicking when they click buy now, instead of it saying, image, buy now. Image, buy now.
It'll tell them what the image is because I've written a description of what that is. I will not write a whole paragraph. I will write a simple sentence.
And my tip for writing these alt texts are, what if you were to describe a picture to someone, to one of your friends over the phone? They may have perfect vision, but they cannot see that picture. How would you describe that picture in a concise sentence over the phone? So if I'm doing a review on the brand new Moto G4 that just came out on Tuesday, I would say, white G4, white Motorola G4 phone. That's a good description of what a picture of this product would be in my article. Again, that's a spot for some keywords, but more focused on accessibility. Alt text helps accessibility. Accessible websites. Accessibility in the real world is a wheelchair on-ramp. Accessibility in the real world is Braille. Is Braille on the signs. If I'm blind and I know Braille, I can read this exit route. That's accessibility in the real world. In the digital world, one of parts of accessibility is alt text. Explain to people that need it, what is this picture? And now the search engines, this used to be a suggestion. Now the search engines insist on this.
So even if it's not something you need to sell, they still want...
Yeah, you probably put that picture on screen for a reason. You want people to see it and appreciate that picture for some reason. Why not also take a moment to write the alt text for the people that can't see it so that they can appreciate it as well? So accessibility has the many reasons of access to more people, social justice, and also the law.
And
yes?
Is it easy to find out how to write the alt text?
Yeah, when we get into WordPress, we'll do it.
And so many factors that we have to think about, isn't it? It's not just, what am I going to write? There are many things to think about.
That's why in our 4-week class, we cover things in a variety of ways, theoretically, and then hands-on, soon, of course. And the more you do it, the more it sticks, and I put it all together as a sort of checklist. The more of these things that you do, the better. And you're going to find plenty of other articles out there that also have many other things, perhaps, that mine doesn't. They're probably all right. It probably worked for them. It'll probably work for you. But here are a variety of concepts to think about that will help you. we have page two to look at, but let's take our first break.
And when we come back, we'll look at page two. I'll turn the printer back on if you'd like to print it. It's 10:53. We'll take a break until 11:03. And we'll look at page two.